Race has been a continuing problem plaguing our criminal and juvenile justice system. And I don't have to recount sort of where we are now in terms of you know, addressing this issue in our justice system. I think that, you know, for many years we've talked about the fact that we have disparate arrest rates and incarceration rates of African Americans and Latinos. And in 2013 and 14, through the Justice Reinvestment Initiative, the Reentry Council commissioned the Burns Institute, who is one of the most respected research organizations in the United States, run and started by James Bell. And they set out to do a study, an in-depth study, on race in the criminal justice system in San Francisco. And this is the third strategy of our Justice Reinvestment Initiative that was referred to earlier. And the goal is ultimately to eliminate racial disproportionality, and from what you'll see in the report, we have a very, very, very long way to go. So the Haywood Burns Institute, they're here today and will provide an analysis of the many decision points that occur from arrest through sentencing and probation. And so what they have done is they've looked at all the available data, some of which was not as good as it should be, and they'll talk about that, but look at every decision point to determine whether or not there's disparate treatment among ethnicities that were included in the statistics that were available, and also to look for a reason why. So Laura Rodolfi and Anna Wong are here from the Burns Institute to do a presentation on their research and findings. Once we hear their presentation, which will go about 20 to 25 minutes, we will have a discussion about those findings and answer any questions that members of the council have. We will have public comment on, you know, any vote from the council as to what to do. And, you know, there are several suggestions that we can consider. So let's turn it over to Anna and Laura for the presentation.
Great. Thank you so much, Jeff. Good morning, everyone. My name is Laura Rodolfi, and I'm the Director of Policy for the W. Haywood Burns Institute. It's really a pleasure to be here this morning to talk about some of the findings from our analysis of racial and ethnic disparities in San Francisco. In your materials, you have a summary of our key findings, a copy of the presentation that we're going to go through today, and a copy of the full report. Given some of the time constraints and to ensure that we have enough time for public comment and for some discussion of next steps, I want you to know that we're going to skip over some of what's included in the presentation, and we'll be available for questions about any of the materials later.
Our viewers, we will have the report available online on the San Francisco Reentry Council website.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Before we get into the findings, I want to tell you a little bit about the Burns Institute. The Burns Institute is a national nonprofit organization that works with local jurisdictions across the nation to investigate and address racial and ethnic disparities in the justice system. Until very recently, our work has been exclusively in the youth justice system. BI was contracted by the to do a decision point analysis to look at the extent of racial and ethnic disparities at five key decision-making points in the San Francisco criminal justice process. Arrests, bookings to jail with a focus on secure bail and pre-adjudication jail time, release to pretrial services, sentencing, and motions to revoke. Before BI started the analysis, we met with stakeholder partners to discuss what questions about disparities we would try to answer with the data, and those questions are available in the full report at Appendix A, which is page 38. Unfortunately, as Jeff mentioned, our analysis was limited significantly by some data limitations. One of the key findings in our report is that the data required to answer some very basic and fundamental questions about disparities were unavailable. And as you and other stakeholders in San Francisco move forward to more fully understand the disparities that are in the report, you will need to build the capacity for a more to build capacity for a more comprehensive and system-wide approach to understanding data disaggregated by race and ethnicity, and develop a process for using that data to drive change. And this will require the commitment of all stakeholder partners. But from the outset, I want to be clear that the limitations on data should not be an excuse for inaction. We believe the findings about disparities that we will outline this morning and that are more fully detailed in the report are a clear call for action. Given the data limitations, I want to spend a moment discussing what the analysis we did is and is not. The report is an important first step in understanding the extent of racial and ethnic disparities in San Francisco. And as those of you who have reviewed the report know, the disparities that are included in the report are stark. People of color, and particularly black adults, are significantly more likely to be involved at all stages of the criminal justice process that we investigated. But the analysis is really just a first step. And I want to go through the Burns Institute strategy for reducing racial and ethnic disparities because I think it will help to illustrate some of what the analysis is and is not. In our work across the nation, we approach data using three basic steps. First, we identify whether and to what extent disparities exist at various decision points. Second, we identify target populations for reform, where we focus our efforts and break the sometimes overwhelming problem of disparities into more manageable pieces, and where we can adopt and pilot different strategies to intervene with those disparities. And then finally, third, we measure the progress and ensure that the interventions we've put in place have the intended outcomes for reducing disparities. The findings that we are going to go over today are really just this first step, the existence of disparities. And it's important to note that the real work and the real reform is in step two. It's there that you will engage with the data. And if you think of this process as peeling back an onion, we've peeled back the first layer and highlighted the extent of the problems. It's your job to start digging into the data and to ask yourself and each other why the disparities exist, to evaluate what policies and practices contribute to those disparities, and to prioritize your target and target your reform efforts. I want to show you just a little bit about the changing demographics in San Francisco. This is something many of you probably know. The adult population has changed substantially over the past 20 years. As you can see, the Latino adult population has increased by 31%, and the black population for adults has decreased by 21%. And this is important for a couple of reasons. First, we need to keep the population numbers in mind as we're looking at criminal justice system involvement. So if we see fewer people of color involved in the system, we need to know how that relates to their decrease in the overall population. And likewise, those increases. And second, we need to be mindful that the criminal justice data that we're collecting is careful to identify both race and ethnicity. This is a chart that shows each criminal justice decision-making point that we reviewed and the proportion of adults disaggregated by race and ethnicity at each point. And here you can see that there are likely some problems in the identification and recording of ethnicity. You can see up here Latino adults appear to be undercounted. And Latino adults, if you can't see it up there, are the green bar in the charts up there. So as you can see here, for example, in the adult population, we see that Latino adults represent 14% of the population, but only 2% of those arrested. The lack of data regarding Latino adults' involvement in the criminal justice system is problematic for a couple of reasons. If we don't understand the extent of the problem, we can't craft the appropriate policy and practice solutions. And additionally, when population data disregard ethnicity and only focus on race, the vast majority of those Latinos are counted as adults, and the result is a likely inflated number of rate of system involvement for white adults, since they're often counted as Latino with the Latino adults. And an underestimation of the disparity gap or the relative rate between the involvement of black and white adults. So the takeaway there, the problems could actually be worse than what we're presenting today because we may be counting a high proportion of those Latino adults with the white adults. Another clear takeaway as we look at these data are that black adults are clearly overrepresented at every stage of the process that we looked at. In 2013, black adults represented 6% of the adult population, but they represented 40% of adults arrested, 44% of adults booked, 49% of adults were eligible for pretrial release, and 40% of adults with a conviction. This slide looks at the data similar, same data in a different way. Here we're looking at the relative likelihood of system involvement for Black adults compared to white adults at the stage of arrest, a booking, and conviction. And to get this analysis, what we do is just look at the rate of involvement for white adults, the rate of involvement for Black adults, and then compare those ratios. And so what you can see here is that for every one white adult arrest in San Francisco in 2013, there were 7.1 Black adults arrested. For every one white adult booked, there were 11 Black adults booked. For every one white adult with a conviction, there were 10.3 Black adults with a conviction. I'm going to look a little bit further into the arrest data that we have. And when BI met with the San Francisco Police Department initially in this process, we learned that they don't currently have the capacity to extract data from their information system to look at arrest by race and ethnicity. Because the data were unavailable, BI looked to information from the Monthly Arrest and Citation Register, which is publicly available from the California Department of Justice. So what you see up here now are arrest rates for San Francisco at large. And you can see that there's been some significant reduction over the past 20 years. For every 1,000 adults in San Francisco in 1994, there were 75 arrests. For every 1,000 adults in San Francisco in 2013, there were 27 arrests. So a 63% reduction. Now we break the data out by race and ethnicity. And again, we're looking at rates because, as I talked about earlier, the demographics have changed dramatically. So we're looking at rates of involvement, not just the numbers. And when we break this out, we can quickly see that the rate of arrest for Black adults, which is that orange line on top, is much higher than the rate for white adults, which is the line towards the bottom in blue. We're interested in how much more likely at each stage. And so for this analysis and for the other analyses that we're going to go through today, we'll compare those rates and look at what we call the disparity gap. So here we'll compare the rates for 1994 and look at the difference in 1994, and then fast forward and look at those differences in 2013. And so what we see here is that despite the reductions in arrests overall, we see that the disparity gap, or the relative likelihood of arrest for Black adults in San Francisco, has actually increased. You can see that in 1994, Black adults were 4.6 times as likely to be arrested, and in 2013, 7.1 times as likely. Another way to think about that is for every one white adult arrested in 1994, 4.6 Black adults. For every one white adult in 2013, 7.1 Black adults. This is similar information, but now we're comparing the disparity gap, or the relative likelihood of arrest for San Francisco, with that of the state of California. And here you can see that whereas the disparity gap in San Francisco is actually increasing, the disparity gap for the state is actually declining. We're closing the gap as a state, but in San Francisco, that divide is growing. I'm going to jump into bookings to pretrial jail. So the next decision point we looked at were bookings to jail, and while this is where we hope to really focus our analysis, the analysis here was really restricted. We weren't able to look at reasons why people of color were booked into jail, disparities in length of stay, jail, pretrial jail, whether people of color have higher bail amounts set, and whether they're less likely to post bail. So clearly there's some work to do to build capacity to better understand the disparities that we're going to look through here. The data we're looking at for bookings includes data from January 1st of 2011 through June 30th of 2014. So first here, when we're looking at rates of booking to jail, we're looking at 2011, 2012, and 2013. And when we look at bookings for Black adults, you can see that the rate of booking has increased by 8% over this three-year period. Notably, you see that the rate of booking for Latino adults, which is in green, has increased significantly. And likely, this increase is due to better data collection around recording ethnicity. But this is certainly something that should be investigated further. When we compare the rates of booking of white adults to Black adults, we see, again, a clear disparity. For every one white adult who was booked into jail in 2013, there were 11 Black adults booked into jail. For every one white adult, there were 1.5 Latino adults. And again, with that big caveat that is probably much higher with better data collection. One of the questions we were able to answer looking at the booking data was where people who are booked into county jail reside. In our work across the nation, we find that it's important to know where people involved in the justice system reside to learn more about the resources that are available in the community and to help create better outcomes for people of color within the community. This chart here shows bookings for 2013, for which we had zip code data available. And please note that we didn't have zip code data available for about 21% of the cases. So what's up here right now are just those data that included zip codes. And so one thing we heard from stakeholder partners was that there's a perception that people come to San Francisco to commit crime. And based on the data we have here, the vast majority of bookings to jail were for residents of the city and county of San Francisco. We also looked at the top zip codes disaggregated by race and ethnicity, and I'm sure that this analysis will not be a surprise to anyone here. For black adults, the top zip codes were within the neighborhoods of the Tenderloin, Bayview, Hunters Point, and South of Market. And for Latino adults, the top zip codes were in the Intermission, Tenderloin, and Ingleside, Excelsior. I'm going to turn it over to another colleague. We also have a third person here from the Burns Institute, Khalid Samurai, and he's going to go through the findings that we have from our pretrial release.
Thank you, Laura. My name is Khalid Samurai. I'm a policy associate at the Haywood Burns Institute. And the next decision point we looked at is pretrial release. The source for this data is the San Francisco Pretrial Diversion Program database. As Laura mentioned at the beginning, there is very limited data on ethnicity, particularly with regard to Latino adults. And for that reason, this analysis will focus only on the disparities between black and white adults.
Could you just take a moment and explain what pretrial diversion is for people who might not know? I also want to acknowledge that the director, Willie Young, is here.
Thank you. Sure. The San Francisco Pretrial Diversion Program is an attempt by the city and county of San Francisco to limit the amount of time adults spend in jail before their court date if they don't pose a flight or risk or a safety risk to the community. And so there are two ways that eligibility for the San Francisco Pretrial Diversion Program is made. First, candidates are found to be either eligible for a pretrial release or not. This is the widest net possible. Then adults are interviewed by someone in the SFPDP program to determine whether they can see a duty commissioner. And actually, this is where the system flow will come in handy. In the diagram, you see at the very top, the yellow boxes, those are all candidates eligible for pretrial release. This is everyone in 2013 who was in the SFPDP database. And then within the SFPDP program, there are three points of release significant to this analysis. First, you see the blue box, other releases. These are individuals who were bailed, cited out, or had their case dismissed while they were within the SFPDP, the pretrial release program. The second point of release within pretrial release is the or pinkish boxes to the left, the presented to duty commissioner. These are adults who are actually presented to a duty commissioner to determine whether they are eligible for OR release or own recognizance release. And the third decision point or point of release is presented at arraignment. And this is all adults who were actually presented at arraignment. And while at arraignment, they could be granted pretrial release at arraignment. Earlier, Laura discussed bookings to pretrial jail. Here we're looking at the last year of data from two different databases, SFPDP and CMS, and comparing the percentages of booked adults who are eligible for pretrial release. The data shows that black adults booked into county jail are more likely than white adults to be eligible for the pretrial release program, including SFPDP. 35% of white adults booked were eligible for pretrial release, and 46% of black adults booked were eligible for pretrial release. Here we are looking at other releases, which were the blue boxes on your flow slide. And we see that 51%, more than one half of all individuals eligible for pretrial release, receive an other release. The portion of eligible white adults who receive other release are higher than the portion of black adults. Black adults are more likely to have their case dismissed, and white adults are more likely to be bailed or cited out. We see that a lot of eligible adults are released before they go into the pretrial release programs. Here we're looking at adults presented to the duty commissioner, and we see that a majority of people are denied an OR release by the commissioner. However, we can also see that white adults are more likely than black adults to be granted an OR release, with 34% of white adults being released and 30% of black adults being released. Now we're looking at adults presented at arraignment. Here we see first that, as I mentioned earlier, 65% of adults eligible for pretrial release were released prior to arraignment. However, a higher proportion of white adults was released prior to the stage. Additionally, white adults are more likely to be granted pretrial release at arraignment than black adults. 30% of white adults are granted pretrial release, and 25% of black adults are granted pretrial release at arraignment. This is an overview of the last full year of data, which we just looked at in the last few slides. The data shows that even though booked black adults are more likely than booked white adults to be eligible for pretrial release, white adults are more likely to be released. We also analyzed the data for the entire 3.5 year timeframe and looked at arraignment specifically. The data shows that white adults are consistently more likely to be granted pretrial release at arraignment than black adults. In the last slide, we saw that white adults are more likely than black adults to be granted pretrial release at arraignment. Here we limit the data by educational status and past criminal convictions over the same time frame. When looking only at adults with a high school degree or a GED, we saw that white adults with a high school degree or GED are almost always more likely to be granted pretrial release than similarly situated black adults. Second, when looking at only at adults with at least one misdemeanor conviction within the past 5 years, we see that white adults with a misdemeanor conviction within the past 5 years are almost always more likely to be released, to be granted pretrial release at arraignment than similarly situated black adults. And finally, the same thing is true for adults with at least one felony conviction within the past 5 years. Now I'm going to pass it to my colleague, Anna Wong.
Thanks. Good morning. My name is Anna Wong. I'm a policy associate at the Burns Institute, and I'm happy to be here. I'm going to talk about our findings from the convictions and sentencing analysis and then some next steps. So this diagram lays out the sentencing options for adults who've been convicted. And on the left, the lighter pink are the least restrictive options. Over to the right are the most restrictive options, which is, you know, essentially state prison. So we looked at the types of sentences that convicted adults received, the length of some of those sentences, and then we were actually also able to look at some of the top charges for which people were convicted in this data set. So the source of the data was the CMS system, and just note that in the first part of the data I present, we looked at the most recent year, but when we get to the actual talking about specific charges, we looked at the whole time frame, which was 3.5 years, just to get a larger sample size. So in this chart on the left, what you're looking at is convictions per 1,000 adults in the population, broken down by race and ethnicity, for 3 years, 2011, 12, and 13. I'm just going to call your attention to the green bars, which represent Latino adults. And it appears as if in 2011, 2.4 Latino adults were convicted per 1,000 in the population, and it goes up to 7 per 1,000 in 2013. So that appears to be a really dramatic increase. Again, Laura pointed this out with the booking data. We believe that that's probably in part due to better data collection, not just some huge increase in the number of Latinos convicted. So it's a good thing if data collection is improving, and that just needs to continue. Over here on the right, the disparity gap for convicted adults is what for every one white adult convicted compared to their numbers in the population, over 10 black adults were convicted, almost 2 Latino adults, and less than 1 Asian Pacific Islander adult. So it's just a snapshot of what the disparity gap looks like at this point. So what types of sentences did people receive? The most frequently used sentence for convicted adults was a combination of a jail and probation sentence. So we're calling that jail probation. It's in the middle. And what we see is that out of all of the convicted white adults, 74% received a jail probation sentence, 21% received a county jail sentence, and 2% of convicted white adults received a state prison sentence. For black adults, on the other hand, 63% received a jail probation sentence, a full quarter received a county jail sentence alone, and 9% received a state prison sentence. And you can see the time frame is up here. It's the latest full year for which we had data. So we also were able to look at the probation, what type of probation adults were placed on. We can see that black adults are more likely to receive formal probation than white adults, and formal is a more restrictive form of probation than court probation, which is informal. We were unfortunately not able to discern who was eligible for formal versus court. So that would be a good next step in the analysis to look at who was eligible and then who got which type of probation. So black adults are more likely to be sentenced to more restrictive sentences. We don't know why at this point, but that's the takeaway. So what are the lengths of sentences that people received? So here we're focusing on the jail probation sentences, not on all of the other types of sentences, because as I just pointed out, this was the most frequently used sentence. And we see from the chart on the left, and so let me take a step back. We're going to look at means and medians. Mean is just a typical average. Median is a sentence, the length where half the sentences are shorter and half the sentences are longer. So for probation sentences, pretty much everyone got 3 years, 36-month sentences. And that shouldn't be a surprise. And I know that, you know, as Jesse pointed out, you all are working on doing changing the way that sentencing for probation is done. And this was true across racial and ethnic groups and gender. We didn't show gender here, but pretty much everyone gets a 36-month probation sentence. But the sentences to county jail varied considerably. So we can see here the median sentence for black adults was 20 days for the county jail portion, for white adults, 10 days. The median for the whole group was 13 days. And for black adults, the average was 63 days, and for white adults, it was 38 days. So as I mentioned, we were able to look at charges for which people were convicted. So here we're switching to the full 3.5-year time frame, so the total numbers are going to be different than just what we were just looking at. The top charge across all racial ethnic groups that people were convicted for was DUI, where the blood alcohol levels were 0.08 or above. And you can see we also highlighted transporting or selling controlled substances here in the list. We talk about that charge a little bit more in the report. We're going to not talk about it here in the interest of time. But I'm going to walk you through what we learned for DUIs. So first of all, for white adults convicted, 18% of all white adults convicted were convicted of DUI. For black adults, it was only 5% of all black adults convicted. And then for Latino adults, it was almost a quarter. 23% of all Latino adults were convicted for DUI. And we were looking here also at the most serious charge people were convicted for. I didn't say that before. And once again, we see jail probation sentences are by far the most frequently used sentence for DUI. So that mirrors the pattern that we saw just generally for sentencing. So we looked at sentence length. And once again, probation sentences were similar across all racial and ethnic groups for DUIs. But black and Latino adults had longer average sentences to county jail than white adults. for this specific charge. So for Latino adults, it was 18 days, Black adults 17, and White adults 13 days. The median was more similar, and for the overall group, it was 8 days. We also looked at the trends over time for state prison sentences. So with all of the reforms happening, it's not surprising that the use of state prison sentences has decreased. But if we focus on the black line, the top line, we see that in the first quarter of 2011, 14% of the total convicted adults were sentenced to state prison. So that was 134 out of 938 were sentenced to state prison. Fast forward to the second quarter of 2014, which was the last quarter we had data for, only 5% of adults were sentenced to state prison, so 52 of 1,087. If for black adults who are represented in orange, in the first quarter, 15% were sentenced to state prison, 15% of all convicted black adults. Fast forward, in the second quarter of 2014, over on the right, you see that 8% of all convicted black adults were sent to state prison. So the use of state prison as a sentencing option is decreasing. For white adults, it goes from 11% to 2%. But what this means is that in the first quarter of 2011, convicted black adults were 1.4 times as likely as convicted white adults to be sentenced to state prison, but that jumps to nearly 4 times as likely as white adults in the second quarter of 2014. So the relative likelihood has actually increased over the time period. We looked at average county jail sentences in the jail probation sentences over time. And we see here that for black and Latino adults, they're consistently longer than for white adults. So earlier I showed you just the latest year, and this shows that over time that has remained true. And then finally, I'm showing you total sentenced bed days to county jail for the last full year. And what we see is that there were almost 300,000 bed days sentenced to county jail as a result of either sentences just to county jail alone or sentences that were jail probation sentences. And black adults account for half of those sentenced bed days. We understand there's a difference between days sentenced and days served, but you know, we have the sentencing data. So those are some of the highlights from our convictions and sentencing analysis. There's, you know, more in the full report. And I just want to take a few minutes to talk about what some of our next steps and recommendations are. So Laura said this right up front, and I'm just going to reiterate that there really needs to be an intentional effort to build data capacity. There were a lot of questions that you know, as you saw, that we could not answer. But we also want to say that improving data is really an ongoing effort. In all of the youth systems that we've worked in around the country, over the years, there are usually data limitations. And we always say, don't use that as an excuse to not move forward with the work to reduce disparities. So they can happen at the same time, building data capacity and starting to look at policy practice change. That being said, where might you start here in San Francisco? So thinking back to what Laura walked you through with our BI process for using data, we focused on step one. Clearly, there are disparities at every decision point we looked at. We encourage you to move to step two, which is identifying target populations and digging deeper to understand where policy and practice change might occur or continue. So we encourage you to look at places in the criminal justice system where black adults are involved at higher rates than white adults, but perhaps there are better alternatives or, you know, they don't need to be involved at all. So we saw that in 2013, for every one white adult arrested, more than 7 black adults were arrested. What's the booking criteria for the San Francisco Police Department? Who gets cited and released, and who's brought to jail and booked in? Think back to the data that Khalid presented at pretrial release. So a substantial portion of people who were booked into jail were released on bail, they were cited out, or they were dismissed. Did they need to be booked into jail in order to protect public safety if they were going to be released or cited out or dismissed a day later or hours later? Who's being dismissed and on what charges? Could they have been cited and released by SFPD? Could they have been diverted? Were they eligible for the DA's neighborhood court program? These are just examples of some of the policy-related questions we would encourage you to begin exploring as you're building your data capacity. We also recommend that you begin developing a system to report on key indicators on a regular basis. So on page 36 of the full report, it's near the end of the report, we provided a number of tables to suggest what types of data you might begin to collect on a regular basis. The table up here is just one example. So broken down by race and ethnicity, looking, we you know, understand you're implementing the risk assessment tool. So understanding the impacts and the decision-making as that tool is implemented, understanding the impacts on different racial and ethnic groups and what the outcomes are is important. And then finally, as you build your data capacity, it's important that someone is reviewing the data and using the data, and it doesn't just sit there in a, you know, in a corner somewhere, but there's a process in place to review and use the data and to inform decision making. So I'll just repeat that we really hope that this analysis is a call to action, and that it's a catalyst for you all as decision makers to continue working to reduce disparities in the justice system. So we thank you for your time, and we'll pass it on to Jennifer to open it up for questions and public comment. Thanks.
On behalf of the council, I want to thank Laura, Anna, and the Burns Institute for their excellent work and for their presentation. We're now going to first have a discussion by members of the council, and I wanted to structure it somewhat. Perhaps if there are any questions regarding the methodology or the findings, we can start there and then go to any general comments and then any specific comments regarding any actions we might take. And then I want to make sure that we have enough time for public comment, since many members of the public who are here. Public comment will be limited to 2 minutes per person, given the time constraints. And obviously, we're not going to be able to cover everything that is in this report. I think the most important thing that we should focus on is what we're going to do about it. So first of all, any comments, questions? Sheriff Mercarini?
I'd like to just underscore our deep appreciation to the Burns Institute and to the representatives who really helped facilitate the study. We know it's not a perfect document. We've had in-depth discussions about the data, and I think that it's important for San Francisco that it really validates what I think many of us already know, and that this information gets citywide. First, just a couple of observations. In my opinion, the Department of Justice data system is so flawed that it makes no, benefit to even incorporate their data system unless we absolutely have to. I think San Francisco is by far more evolved than DOJ, especially when it comes to the disaggregating of white and Latino populations. DOJ fails miserably on counting both Latino / Hispanic populations, and it has really become a liability, especially in our experience during realignment, where I think all local criminal justice systems have to compensate because of those defects on a state level. Second, it's really kind of dramatic, if not radical, that if the data and the data that holds true is suggesting that 80% of crimes being convicted are not, or of people within San Francisco, dispels a complete narrative that we've been hearing from the press and frankly from organs of law enforcement that is suggesting a much higher intrusion and injection of crime being conducted from outside sources like in the East Bay. And if that in fact is true, I think that that completely reorients a discussion both in general population, in City Hall, and the press, which does, I think, a hyper job of trying to demonize other populations that are not in San Francisco, which in its attempt is trying to elevate the pretense of San Francisco. And I think that the data in itself really demystifies an arrogance that exists in San Francisco if, in fact, that we want to hold steady and back that particular data up. But until now, when you read press accounts or when you hear elected officials and others that talk about where the elements of crime are coming from, cavalierly, they're sort of deflecting that, oh, it's folks from the East Bay or folks from somewhere else. And I think, frankly, that's just simply an excuse not to deal with the problems before us and an excuse to just kind of sweep things under the rug. Thirdly, on what to do, and then I'll pass this on. This is very important data, and it corresponds with a very important process that's underway at City Hall right now, and that's our budgeting. Our budgeting that all the department heads and people that are affiliated with a number of departments that are vying for and working to develop, I think, a healthy budget, I would say that none of this data is well supported by a budgeting process that we're underway right now. When I hear that we are committing, and the argument's not about whether we have more police or not more police, I think the argument is about, are we actually injecting the kind of resources that are going to attend to the next biannual budget process that's going to back us up to be able to look and do something real with this data? I'm not aware of any particular department, the Criminal Justice Circle, that's a member of the Reentry Council or the CCP, or the Sentencing Commission, which is relatively most of the same players, that our budgeting has been changed or enhanced in any way to say that we're going to make an earnest effort to do something about the data that is before us. That means that we have to wait for phase two and any other subsequent phases to then return back to the City Hall budgeting process to say, aha, we've got data 12 months or 24 months later, and it says that we should have funding that supports this change in practices. And I think that we can't afford that time to lose or to waste, and that if before the budget is solidified within the next week and a half with the Board of Supervisors, I would even take the leap of faith to suggest that if we were able to crystallize, I think, something meaningful to members of the Board of Supervisors and hopefully Room 200 and others, that there would be some well-resourced strategies that back up the data that is before us so implementation is not stalled. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments by members of the council? Questions?
I have a question. Joyce Crum, San Francisco Human Services Agency.
Could you speak into the microphone? Just
sure. Joyce Crum, San Francisco Human Services Agency, Director of the Housing and Homeless Division. Just particularly about the top convicted charges. Under battery, is there a breakout on whether or not battery includes domestic violence? That's a question that I have.
The specific charges and domestic violence is included in a different charge, and so the specific charges for conviction are included in Appendix D. Okay. And then those are also broken out by the sentence type for each of the different top 25 convicted
All right.
offenses.
Thank you. And my second question is, was there a reason why the ethnicity was not broken down between males and females? And was it all males?
We did break down the data in the report looking for at convictions by male and female, and we saw similar disparities for men and for women in the system.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. I think there's a question from Mr. Farnsworth on from State Parole.
Yeah, basically I'd like to mirror what Ross was saying and just ask the question, is there any correlation for gathering and correlating the socioeconomic data? I mean, we have a nice targeting of what neighborhoods and stuff, so that would be obviously a good place to start saying, where do we place services to address some of this stuff to impact the contact with the criminal justice system before it even happens? So are we going to take this data and maybe mine it a little further for correlating your social economic data into, you know, the types of crimes being committed, and then developing programs to target specifically those neighborhoods and those individuals that could really use the services before they contact the criminal justice system? I've noticed a huge disparity on the top line of, you know, drinking and driving is for white males. Well, we do ad campaigns against domestic violence, and those are targeted for gender and ethnicity. Why aren't we utilizing this data to start looking at that stuff, going, can we do ad campaigns, can we do programming, et cetera, that will have an impact on the overall criminality in San Francisco?
Thank you. So I think that question is whether we can drill down further and get more socioeconomic information about individuals, such as their income level, employment.
Yep.
Is that a question that can be answered right now, or?
In the data that we have, we can't do that analysis, but we would also say that in our experience in the youth justice system, controlling for every factor that we do know is related to, you know, sometimes the way people behave and make their living, whether it's legal or illegal, that, you know, we're, the way that we have found progress to be made in the youth justice system is focusing on providing resources and alternatives to detention, alternatives to jail, diversion programs, regardless of people's socio, you know, regardless of whether we know exactly what the socioeconomic level is or not, that we should be providing these alternatives if people do not need to be in the system, if they're not a serious public safety threat. What else can we do to try to ensure that everyone has positive outcomes? So we would, you know, say, find, you know, invest in those neighborhoods that we see are the top zip codes contributing to pretrial jail, regardless of whether we know exactly what the socioeconomic status is. We know that there's services that are needed.
Okay, thank you. We're going to go to Ernest Kirkwood, and then Christina, you had a comment.
Yeah. Good morning again. I want to piggyback a little bit off of what Mr. Farnsworth said. It's just an observation. The whole thing with the statistics and the whole preparation of this is very good, okay, and it's probably very active, accurate. But what concerns me is that in looking at this, this is the symptom. This is the symptom, all right? We need to focus on the cause, all right? To not to focus on the cause turns this into smoke and mirrors. That is what I'm concerned with, the cause. All this, this good, you just spend a lot of money on this, you know, and it sounds good. Presentations was outstanding, thank you. But we need a dialogue on calls. Thank you.
Thank you. Christine?
Thank you. Hey, it's never a good day to come to work and hear news like this. I wish I could say I was surprised by it, but I don't think any of us that have been working in criminal justice are surprised by the numbers, or we shouldn't be. But what it is another reminder of how urgent the need is to act on these issues, both identifying the cause and also taking accountability for our individual agencies and the role that we play in contributing to these issues. The district attorney has been looking fervishly at this since we got draft copies of it, and we have been, even prior to receiving this, talking about how we can do more in our own department to reduce the disparities that we contribute to and those that we inherit from other agencies. And I think that the work we need to do now going forward is make sure that we hold ourselves and that you all hold us accountable to making those improvements, because to wait another 2 years and receive another report that tells us we continue to have disparity in our criminal justice system will be wholly unsatisfactory to myself and the district attorney, and I'm sure hopefully many people at this table, certainly all of you that have taken time out of your days to come here and hear this. Within our own office, we have already identified a research partner that we would like to work with to do a deeper dive on our own data, which is somewhat represented here, but not entirely, because we know that we need to look even closer at what charges people are being brought for and what we are doing with them on those charges, who we're deciding to charge, what we're deciding to charge them with. And I want the community that's here listening to know that we're committed to doing that work, and we will do that work, and we will report out to you what we learn from that work, because we need, as was indicated at the very beginning of this presentation, this is step one, and now we need to understand where the problems are in our part of the process and how we improve those. And until we look at our charging and how we resolve cases through plea bargains and trials and sentences, we won't yet be able to tell you what we can do to improve it. I can let you know that a study that was done in the Manhattan District Attorney's Office showed that the greatest disparity existed at the lower level crimes. You know, at things such as homicides and sexual assaults, we see less racial disparity because people are treated largely similarly in those contexts. Where you see the greatest amount of disparity, at least in Manhattan, and I would think it's safe to assume perhaps in our own community, is around drug offenses, property offenses, things where there's opportunities to give people a chance to rehabilitate themselves and take a different course. And that is where the racial disparity tends to creep in most significantly in the work that we do. And so the good news is that San Francisco has been on a path of reducing the amount of drug prosecutions that we're engaged in and trying to really identify more diversion and programmatic opportunities for people on those charges. But there's obviously, as a result of this data, still much work to be done there. And I look forward to working in my own office on that and hopefully with others of you that are concerned around that. The other issue I do want to raise, aside from our individual departments' quests on these things, this city is obviously, as is the country, having a conversation around race and policing and the criminal justice system. And if San Francisco wants to continue to be at the forefront, as it claims itself to be in many areas, it is our opportunity now to step forward and be brave and be honest about the problem that we have in this country, and that this community is not exempt. Living at the tip of a peninsula on the west coast of the country does not make us immune from racism or anything else that can happen in the United States, and we need to be honest with ourselves about that. And I think I've been engaged in a number of conversations in this city recently where I think we kid ourselves into thinking that because we are progressive, we can't possibly be racist or have racist tendencies. And I would like to disavow ourselves as a government agencies of those beliefs, because they are harmful to real people, they're harmful to communities, and we have obligations in the roles that we're in to do these jobs with everybody's best interest in mind. And this report indicates that we have a long ways to go on that. The budget is a very important topic that was raised here, and I think it bears repeating that the biggest policy document in this city is our budget. And where we spend those dollars is telling everybody what we care about. So if you are concerned about criminal justice issues in the city and what we're doing with our dollars and how we're working on these issues, that is the document to look at. Anything that my department does or any of these individual departments do pales in comparison to how $9 billion is spent in this city. And if we want to address these issues, there's money available to do it, but it needs to be allocated to those purposes. And I think we need to look and ask ourselves, with much respect to all my partners here, how many police officers we need, how many jail beds we need, and we need to have an honest conversation about this report in that context.
Jeff.
Thank you. Joseph?
I would just like, as stated, you know, these numbers.
Could you speak into the microphone?
These numbers obviously show us the problem that we all already know existed. So the question's not about institutional discrimination or institutional racism. I think the question's more centered around the specifics of what we can do, obviously, right? So my challenge to the Reentry Council and the city, period, is how do we do that locally? How can we change that, and what does that look like? It sounds really good today, and everyone's saying really good things, but ultimately I'd love to come to this table and know what each department's actually doing and how I can help if needed. But, you know, we do need more programs. We do need more prevention, more intervention. We know this. So I agree with what you said. You know, where the money goes is where we really show the importance. So let's follow the money and hold, you know, hold our local officials accountable. Make sure your voice is heard. This isn't new news. This is old news. So let's come up with some new solutions, and let's be solid with them and sit at the table and understand that we're working together towards that, towards housing, towards resources for those that are coming home. But the prevention and intervention that we need in our communities where the problem does exist. As Mr. Kirkwood said, it's a symptom. Prison's a symptom. It's the sore. What's the cause? How can we fix it? Thank you.
Just to address that question, you know, what we can do, I did ask that question of the reentry staff. One suggestion that they had that, you know, would be available to the council is that they do have, you know, some funding that they could devote to bringing in either a agency like the Justice Reinvestment Initiative that has worked on this project. I think they're in the process of applying for additional funding there, or to bring in a professional who could provide facilitated discussion about, you know, what actions we could take. The idea would be is that a facilitator or a criminal justice professional would talk to each of the departments about what they could do and put together a comprehensive action plan going forward. Now, we're talking about an action plan that involves doing things as opposed to just saying things. And I think that, give you one example. Supervisor Malia Cohen has introduced legislation before the Board of Supervisors that would require the police department to report on data relating to ethnicity and gender with respect to traffic stops, arrest, stop and searches, all the various points of police contact. I mean, that's an example of a specific, in that case, legislation that would result in a specific outcome, and that information would be reported quarterly. She also required that same information of the Sheriff's Department. Another example of a reform that's been talked about, although not implemented yet, is having the police department engage in mandatory training on unconscious or implicit bias. And that's something that certainly could also be required of my department, the Public Defender's Office. We've had two trainings in the last 2 years and found that to be very fruitful. I know the district attorney has done the same. But that's, again, another example of a specific training, proposal, you know, that could be implemented. So with that, let me ask the council again whether there are any specific ideas to put forward. And if we take any action, what we need to do then is have a public comment, which we will. Oh, Commander?
Thank you. First of all, I'd have a few comments and actually a question. First of all, I'd like to echo Mr. Kirkwood's comments that this study tells us what is going on. It doesn't tell us why. So we really need to look deeper as to the why of it and why we're seeing the numbers. And I think that's the important next step. Second, I think, you know, there's been a lot of discussion about budget and money, but I also think it's very important that we don't lose sight of what we can do within our own means, within our own individual agencies to address some of the issues that we're seeing. And I think a big part of it, at least for the police department, is investment in communities where we're seeing disproportional higher numbers of arrests where these are coming from, or individuals that are subject or would be at risk of higher arrest. And it really is, the police department has really tried to invest in those community groups, really working with the youth, and have been doing that for a number of years, which really kind of speaks towards President Obama's 21st century policing and really trying to develop that community trust and the guardianship. And that's something that the police department has been working on and continues to work on. And just to acknowledge some of the comments, Mr. Adachi, about traffic stops and data collection. That's a very important piece. The San Francisco Police Department has been collecting data for a number of years regarding traffic stops and are currently moving towards collecting similar data regarding pedestrian stops. And in respects to implicit bias, another very important piece of our discussion. That's something that the department and Chief Sir has been moving forward with. We recently attended implicit bias training for all the top command of the police department captains as well, and really are working towards providing that through the basic academy and then also trying to get that started through advanced officer training. All important pieces and all things that we can work on now and take steps on while we get the answers of the why behind the what. And then just one other question regarding the study that I have. In terms of arrests versus bookings, in terms of that data, was that collected at in terms of type of arrest versus booking? So was that looked at the types of arrest that were charged or were booked as?
Yeah, the only arrest data we have was from the monthly arrest and citation, which we acknowledge is not a good source of data. And what we understood is that the police department didn't have the capacity to extract the data, so sort of the best that we could get. And that data is not broken out by what the disposition is. On the DOJ website, they show who's released or not, but it doesn't show who is cited and released, who's booked in jail. And so for the booking data, which is an entirely separate database from CMS, is all of the adults who are booked into jail. So it's two completely different sources and tell us very different things.
Thank you.
Thank you, Commander. Are there any more comments from the council before I'm going to open it up to public comment? Oh, I'm sorry. Paul Henderson?
I did. What are we doing after public comment? Are we moving on to the next topic?
Yeah, we have, just so everyone is aware, we have, I think, four short agenda items.
Okay, I just didn't know if we were going to readdress the issue after public comment, so I'll make my comments now, is that I would ask, and we've done this in the past, but I think this is a really important topic. I think it's really important information that we have. What I would like to see is if we can come together to form some sort of working group as we've done in the past. Mm-hmm. So we're not just having a conversation about this information and then we move on and we get another report in a year or in 2 years or in 3 years. But it sounds to me as though this council is adequately concerned. I know the public is concerned about this issue. What I'd like to see is a working group crafted out of this information where we start and looking more specifically at some of these intransigent problems and having regular report outs about these specific issues from this report here at the Reentry Council. And I'm specifically talking about the data collection, which I think has been a problem. It's been constantly referenced by the producers of the report. It's a phenomenal report. But let's start trying to examine where and how the data collection can be improved and then renew the focus or at least some call-outs or conversations with commitments about some of the opportunities to address some of the prevention and interventions that are necessary, particularly at the beginning of the pipeline. I just don't want us to deteriorate into a period where we're just pointing the finger at the individual agencies that may be accountable for small slices of this problem and this issue, because it's a collective issue. So I want to try and address and build something that's solution-oriented moving forward beyond just our conversation. So that's my suggestion.
Okay. Could we have a formal motion to that effect? And the only thing I would ask that we add to that is that we authorize the Reentry Council staff to take the steps necessary to obtain the resources to facilitate the specific recommendations that would come back to the council.
It was my suggestion. I'll make the formal ask or ask for the formal authorization for a working group to be initiated immediately.
Okay.
Second.
Yeah.
Okay, before we take a vote, we're going to have public comment on that.
Just for the minutes, can someone just repeat the motion So we know exactly what it is that you all are voting
sure.
for.
Sure, and I think we've done this in the past with specific issues, but the motion is to establish a working group with a number of the partners that are involved in the criminal justice system to regularly report out on and address some of the issues that have been raised with this report, both to this council and to the public, specifically focused in the areas on data collection, prevention, and intervention strategies, collectively, not individually.
I have a question in regards to your proposal. I can support that, but what I want to ask is that when this is set up and we have this discussion, okay, is the community going to be part of this? Or is this going to be another isolation thing?
I think that's an open discussion. I don't know that, for me, in my mind, is what I was proposing. In my mind, I want to talk specifically with the agencies individually and not have, maybe there can be two parts of it, but I think it's important that we have individual conversations collectively for the criminal justice partners, and then maybe an open forum or an open opportunity for public or communities to give input, suggestions, or modifications on in terms of what gets brought up or what solutions are crafted.
I think the two part is doable, you know, because it's been my small little bit limited experience of that. There is a lot of meetings and discussions going on that does not involve the community, all right? And that's what we're supposed to be about, and that's not happening. You know, so in looking at this situation and setting up a possible dialogue or whatever, the community must be involved.
Well, that's right. I don't disagree with you, and that's in part why I said that the group, the working group, after it's put together, should be reporting back not just to this council but to the public as well as part of the Reentry Council.
Well, perhaps we could have a friendly amendment that would direct the whoever does this inquiry to include the voices, opinions of members of the community. And I would assume that means nonprofit organizations, community leaders, religious
Absolutely.
Leaders, formerly incarcerated individuals, and so on.
Absolutely.
Okay, so do you have that? Okay, we're gonna now move to public comment because I see many people who want to speak on this issue. We are going to have to limit each public comment to 2 minutes, but please share your views. And thank you for being here.
First of all, I want to thank the council. I don't know if I'm going to be 2 minutes. My name is Frank Williams. I'm a community leader. I'm the director of the Senior Ex-Offender Program. I've been working with the criminal justice system for 18 years. And I like to say, first of all, I want to give my kudos to San Francisco Sheriff Department, to Adult Probation, and to the District Attorney Office. Right around the time of 2006, when I'm one of the first ones that was on this Reentry Council, when Public Defender Jeff Adachi and now Sheriff Mercurimi put this thing together. And to me at that time, and still to this day, from Attorney General Kamala Harris, also having the Reentry Council as well, that in San Francisco, I'm very proud to even today still say that San Francisco is in the forefront of change for reentry. And with the passing down of California realignment, the outstanding job that Adult Probation is doing today, we are seeing a reduction. However, we are also seeing, I'm astounded by hearing things about prison as a symptom and we don't know where all this is coming from. Since 1983, San Francisco had the highest incarceration rate of African Americans. 48% of them jails was African Americans out of 11% of the population. Today is 56% out of 3% and not 6%. So some of these stats is a little off. I'm still astounded by how it's people are afraid to have a discussion about African Americans. Even African Americans cannot really have a discussion about African Americans. And so to my city officials, in which we do have some African Americans even in place that are afraid to talk about our issue, I'm not running for office. I'm not scared to say what I feel, but I represent these formerly incarcerated people and the incarcerated people because I'm a product of them. So when we sat on this reentry council to make change, we expect to see change. Why did it take 30 years for us to get to where we at right now? Why has it taken 30 years for this to happen? And it's just astonishing to me that how we talking about the disparity of African Americans when everybody been making money off African Americans. Our district attorney office, the only thing they asked for was for some more social workers so they can do an intervention. Why are they not getting the money they need for social workers for at the district attorney office? Sheriff department got money taken from them to help with AB 109. Why they not being reinvested that money to help them with the AB 109? So we got city officials that's sitting up here also who's going through the same struggles. Our nonprofits, which there is no African-American nonprofits inside these county jails, that's based. We got an institution that's still studying our people, and not one on there I seen was African-American. Yeah, I'm talking up about it. We keep outsourcing San Francisco to bring in people from New York, Chicago, and everywhere else to tell us about our own people and our own culture. We got 18-year-olds. I work across the street from young community developers, and them young kids for the first time got a hard hat, and they get a job for 3 months, and then they job in, and they outsourced. Where they going? You looking at those rates about breaking and entering? You looking at them rates about drug crimes? Do you know why? They not getting no jobs. That's the symptom. It's not the prison that's the symptom. Dr. Peter Sill has been telling us for years, who've been studying the criminal justice system, for those that read about it, that only 17% of 164,000 incarcerated inmates have received some type of intervention. 17%. And you asking us, and you telling us here now why we got a high recidivism rate and why it's not working, and everybody act like they don't know why it's working. You know why it's working. Money come down from the federal system down to the criminal justice system, and by the time it hit our community-based program, those of us that care to work 18 to 20 hours nonstop, that work 18 to 20 hours nonstop, where I'm paying my people $20 an hour who care about this population, we only get broke off $200,000-$300,000. Where the rest of the money going? Where's it going? Even Department of Public Health, we got a systemic thing called fear and trust out there in our communities. Our communities is never in these rooms. I sit on the CCP. I sit in a lot of these closed room discussions about African Americans. And I keep seeing the same thing over and over and over again. And then we sit here and act like we don't know why this is happening. What money is really being put into our youth? Why they not getting jobs? Why they graduate from school? Why people graduate from Five Key Charter School? How many of them getting jobs? Where are they? But we bringing in big businesses. We bringing in big businesses into our city, San Francisco, where we know that that youngster right there will not be working for Apple. He will not be working for Twitter. They not being taught that in these schools. And we're not even talking about the educational system. I had to take my daughter out of one of the education systems because the way they was teaching her.
Okay, Frank.
I'm not finished.
Okay.
I'm not finished, sir.
With all due respect, sir.
What I'm getting at is that right now we're in the forefront, and what's happening right now is happening for a good reason. We have the right people in office right now.
I understand, but I got to be respectful of other people who want to speak.
I'm going to be respectful,
too, sir.
And came here and waited to speak.
All right?
Public Defender Jeff Adachi, I got 1 second, please. My proposal is that we increase the capacity of with the San Francisco Sheriff Department, the Adult Probation Department, what the District Attorney Department is trying to do and find funding to increase that and to put that together with the community-based organizations that are really doing the work and to improve the data systems. where we can have our data input put in there properly, and where we can bring in people that's really trained to do this work to reduce recidivism. That's what I'm trying to get to, if you don't mind. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
My name is George Bracey, and I'm the voice of the trans community and cisgender community. You know what the problems are. I've been here 30 years, and I know what the problems are. You know what the problems are. You have solutions, and you have the political will to do or not to do, and you have that culture of austerity. If you were to set aside that culture of austerity and start fully implementing programs that work with that work towards these ends, and if you were to invest in communities that are community peer-based organizations that are actually doing the work, and if you were to take some cuts in your own paychecks, you know, things would be a lot better for a lot of the people in the community.
Thank you.
My name is Marilyn, and I didn't give y'all about 20 years of my life, so I might go over 2 minutes, too. I just want to go on the record as saying San Francisco is one of the most racist cities in America. And you're sitting here like you don't know why. You know, I have this last night, I was just got real depressed because I don't have no more black men to support me. You took 30 years to come out with this study. Everybody's in prison or they're dead. I don't have a support system. And the police don't protect black women like they protect white folks. So you don't know what the problem is. It's racism. They pull us over more, and then you want to count. You keep counting. You know, in the penitentiary, two times a day, you got to stand up by your bunk, and they call it count time. That's what these high-cost research studies are, body counts. You keep counting black folks over and over. You can count me 50 million ways. So when you find out that the police pulled me too much, what you going to do to him? Quit counting. I can tell you it's way too many people. We don't need no more data. You need to take that money that you spend counting us and put it in the black community. It's a damn shame that you count us so many ways. I got a master's degree. I have been in penitentiary 5 times, but I got a master's degree, so I had to study how many times you count black people. You ain't got to keep counting when you're jealous 65% black. Understand you got racist cops, you got racist DA, everybody's racist. So what you gonna do about them? If you can't do nothing about their hearts, but you can do something in the black community. You trying to change the master, the one who caused this. Do you really think that you're gonna get in their hearts and minds and make them not pull me over? Or my son's over. You know, you make black boys sit on the ground when you pull them over. I ain't never seen no white man sitting on the ground in San Francisco. Stop doing that. You know you do that. And you do anybody know what I'm talking about? When black folks get pulled over in the hood, the boys gotta sit on the ground? I've never seen that in a white neighborhood. So you don't have to research that. Know how you do us. And quit playing, you wanna know why. That's more of a stall. Crack arrived, I don't care about that. Crack arrived in 1985. It's 2015, and you wanna know why. We live in the projects in San Francisco. That's what you got put out for us, little plantations. And you wanna know why my son wanna sell some drugs. Because he can't afford to move across the damn street. You stopped all our movement in this city. You took all the land. I was born and raised here in Western Addition when it was all black. You took all the land, confined us to these projects, and you wanna know why. Quit playing. Can you make it possible for us to move out the projects? You talking about us getting out the projects? Have you ever lived in the projects? That's where I took my first hit of crack cocaine, in the projects. And the government helped bring it here and targeted us black people. And y'all know this too, right? But then they locked us all up at the end. And you wanna still find out why? Ask yourself why. You ain't gotta study me to find out why y'all racist. You're racist. That's why. You got worse statistics than Ferguson, Missouri. 15 times the population rate. You're racist. Both my sons, I got adult sons. They both got felony convictions. You think it's by accident? Y'all racist. You mistreat my sons. You mistreated me. I've gotten my ass whooped and called the police. Police ain't did nothing. A couple times in San Francisco. But when he touched his wife barely, she's protected. You don't protect us the same. You don't treat us the same. And quit asking why. Please don't spend too much time in a data collection. Because you can call me up, I'll give you my phone number, and I'll tell you where to go to. You ask where we should go, try the projects. You can take a ride. You don't need a research study to find out where to go. Get in your car and ride the block. Quit playing and stalling for time. Because in my case, it's too late. Everybody's gone. All the men I had are gone. And you want to ask about why. So stop that data collection stuff. Quit playing. Go take a ride in your car. It doesn't or talk to some convicts. You ain't got to hire no million-dollar firm to tell you what's going on in the city. Put a couple convicts down, and we'll tell you where to go. Quit playing. And a lot of us are out of work, too, by the way.
Thank you.
I'm going over. My name is Galen Logan Jr. I'm the founder and CEO of Village Connect. I want to thank you individually and collectively for being on this council and for your commitment to this subject and this subject matter. I'm hopeful. You cannot bottle the reality that black people are facing right now. And I hope you understand that. So to put us in 2-minute segments, and I understand this is a system and this is a process and we have to have that in order to keep order. But as a black man, I'm gonna say this first before I get into my comments. As a black man and as a black father and as a black grandfather, I am extremely concerned. I'm extremely concerned. I am extremely disturbed by what's happening in our country. If it was you, and if it was your children, and if you're not black, this would be a state of an emergency. This would be in a state of an emergency, and we would exhaust every resource possible to address this issue. But unfortunately, it's not your children, and it's not your community, and it's not your families, and I am not throwing any stones. Our mission at Village Connect is to build the capacity of people to become more self-aware and self-directed, resulting in sustainable, positive transformation. That is our mission. And what I want to highlight in our mission is self-awareness. What I've come to find in my own personal journey is that the more self-aware I become, the clearer I can see you. The more self-aware I become, the more clearly I can see this system that I reside in. And I'm gonna just say the word. System of white supremacy. System of white supremacy. I wanna make these quick comments and I will move on. I wanna couch them in 3 words. The what, the why, and the how. As I mentioned, self-awareness is key. What I also find with self-awareness and as it grows is that I become clear about my purpose and I become clear about my direction. I believe that the criminal injustice system has purpose and it has direction. The criminal injustice system has purpose and it has direction. Why are we not talking about where we're headed with this? Because we are heading somewhere. And for us to act and believe as though this is just coincidence and all of a sudden this stuff just started happening is ridiculous and you insult my intelligence when we continuously keep having these conversations. Where is the criminal injustice system taking black people? Where is the criminal injustice system taking brown people? I want to talk about the why. And the cause and the effect, and as the man stated up earlier about the root cause as opposed to focusing on symptom. I want to acknowledge the San Francisco Adult Probation Department for its innovative strategies that they're attempting to employ. I also want to acknowledge our sheriff, and the DA's office for their innovative attempts at doing something different, but it's not enough. I'm sorry, it's not enough. How? I just want to make one very clear statement around this. As our jails and as our prison systems are incubators for criminality, as we know, our community and our families are incubators for life and love and peace. And so as you talk about supporting community-based efforts, please understand that if you've attempted things in the past and it didn't work, that's not a reason to stop attempting to support our community. And there's those of us in the community who know how to love our people and who know how to support our people and to hold our people accountable. We don't seem to get an opportunity to do that very often. So I just want to ask, I want to implore you to be the first-class, top-notch city that you are around controversial issues and take a stand and show the nation how it could be done. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Michael Redd. I'm the son of George and Norma Redd. I grew up here in San Francisco. Thank you for this information, but it's not I'm not a stranger to it. Some of you know me. I've been working in this field, working with people who in reentry, people who are suffering with the substance abuse, mental health, in the criminal justice system and out. And I'm angry. I'm really angry. On June 5th, 2 years ago, my stepson was killed by a police officer in South San Francisco. And he's a victim, which made me a victim, which made his friends victims, their parents victims. And this is policy. There was no formal apology for the homicide of my son. What I want to ask you is, how does this data transform the lives of those who are affected by these policies? What do we do when we don't have anyone to come to, and we elect you to protect us, to help us, to increase our lives, the quality of our lives? And what we become is victimized again. The challenge is for you who are in power to make better decisions that will, I'm sure that this is not news to you. In your day-to-day lives, you see the number of people that come through your systems and those conversations that you have in the hallway or over lunch. Do you talk about them? Do you talk about the problem and how to address it? This is nothing new in the black community. I grew up here in San Francisco, and our communities are shrinking down to 3%. The unemployment rate is so high. YCD across the street, we see young people come in. I work right now for the Senior Exponents Program. And right now, across the street, I see kids hungry for employment. And the opportunities are dwindling for them. I worked for the Glide Foundation for many years in Youth Build America. And we had programs to help them to develop skills so that they would have sustainable income and they would change not just their lives, but those of their families. There's building here, and when I drive down, there's so much building going on in San Francisco. When I drive down the street, I don't see these young people. I don't see them on the job, and I know they're qualified. These are some of the answers to some of the questions of why we find ourselves incarcerated. Because these young people, as well as our older people who are impacted by coming home from prison and all of their friends are dead, all those their friends and their resources are dried up. There's nothing for them. are impacted by this data that shows that there is a problem and that we're challenged with addressing it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Wow, those are some tough acts to follow. My name is Kevin Henley, and I've been working in the criminal justice system, I would say, for the last 8 years. Also, I oversee some transitional housing here in San Francisco. And the reason I'm here today is not necessarily to continue to talk about problems, but I think that we should start moving toward into solutions. One of the things that compelled me was I work in a jail, so I'm there like 2-3 times a week. One of the most heartbreaking things that happened to me last week was I went into one of the jails, and it was like 11 people that I went to high school with. So it was like a high school reunion in jail. It was ridiculous. And these guys are my age, and I'm not young. So one of the things that I wanted to say is that, you know, statistics and stuff like that are really good in data. Sheriff Mike Hennessy, before Sheriff Ross Mercurimi, came out with a study of his own way back in 2008. And the thing that I found out that the statistics from 2008 until today has not changed. So I kind of get bored with, oh, let's look at the statistic. Oh, look at it again. Let's look at it again. But here's what Sheriff Hennessy said, quote, "It seems clear that civic leaders, politicians, whether they're in government or private industry, should give greater support to substance abuse and employment opportunities in order to impact that particular segment of society." Now, he said that 7 years ago, but we're still on his wheel. The other thing that I see that's very important is that we need to come up with a strategy. Now, one of the things that I found out is I had a conversation with a person that works at the mayor's office. He should go nameless because he got mad at me. What I told him is that, sorry, I got to finish this. What I told him was that, you know, the mayor's office has to take more of a responsibility for this. Mayor Lee has brought in Twitter and Dolby and a variety of high-tech companies, which has made this city a very, very wealthy city with a lot of young people with disposable cash. I don't see them spending any money in the communities. I don't see them reaching out. So what I said is I wrote him a letter and said, would you give this to our current standing mayor? In order for Twitter and Dolby and any of these other companies to get these tax breaks, it has to be reinvested back into reentry services and affordable housing. Or otherwise, they shouldn't get those tax breaks because that's like welfare for rich people and corporate. So I really didn't understand why you can't take some of these monies. I mean, the other thing is lawyers, teachers, firemen, emergency services people, they can't even afford to live there anymore. Hell, some of us in this room probably can't even afford to live there anymore. One of the things is that we should take the digital divide and really start attacking that. That's just my portion of what I see should be done. I mean, I love President Obama. We don't need no more Obama phones. We need some Obama computers. We should have the digital divide is one of the most, it's a big cultural phenomenon, economic, I'm gonna use the word racism. That's economic racism in a way because it's not divvied out proportionally. If you go to jail and you talk to most of these people, most of it because of lack of education, you attack the digital divide in education. I just went to this marvelous, thank you for the sheriff, Kim and people like that, just a marvelous graduation of Five Keys Charter. And the statistics prove that those graduates have a less likely time of reoffending than ones that not. So let's put the mayor on blast and on notice. No more tax breaks, no more welfare for the rich and for Twitter unless it's proportionally divided amongst the reentry and the people out here who really need it and these community-based agencies, or else I'm not gonna pay my taxes no more.
Hey, thank you.
Hi, my name is James Robinson. I'm a native San Franciscan. And I just wanna say I
work with Lou Gordon and Kevin Henley and representing M3, George Moran. And 5 years ago, I wasn't even involved in this industry. And Kevin been telling me about the disparity, because I come from the board and care with the elderly. And once I got in it and got with Lou and George Moran going into the prison system, I see a lot of my high school friends. Well, me and Kevin all grew up together. And it's shocking, because I've never been arrested. And when I seen it, it's like, wow. And it's gotta be a change. Even my niece is incarcerated. And now she's out. But thanks to Hennessy and Ross with the programs and the other people over here, Adami and the rest of you guys, you know who you are. And I see all the innovation, because I was like the public saying, you know, lock them up. You know, they get their high school, you know, their college stuff, and we got to work to do it, because I've never been incarcerated. But now, since I've been involved in it and going into the jails, I see the disparities. I've been enlightened and hopeful. And I just want to say, you know, just keep up the good work with everybody here. I'm proud to be here.
Thank you.
Roma Guy from Taxpayers for Public Safety. And I just wanted, whether you get the work group together or not, which I think is a good idea, I want to say that I support a lot of what you all said today, and I want to be a part of the solution. And I am a member of the public. I don't hold, you know, a decision-making position, but the voters do make the final decision at one point, and we will be working on that part too. So I wanted to add that. And a lot of the things have been said, training, et cetera, are a good thing, and that this is a symptom that we need to be brave, even though it's been repeated for 100, 200 years, that racism is at the core of what we've constructed in the United States. And we need more accountability. But I want to talk about what drives some of these decisions that hasn't been mentioned yet. Land policy and construction drive policy, and that includes social policy. If we don't have enough treatment beds, but we have enough twitters, that's land policy. And if you look at where we arrest people, including for DUIs, you look at your retail alcohol shops if you want to. That's land policy. When we built the hall of juvenile hall for 150, that was land policy driving social policy. Today, there are 50 youth there for 150 placements. We are paying for that high interest rate out of our general fund, and we overbuilt. And 60% of the youth there are African Americans. That is racism. Let's dig deep. Let's face it. What percentage of the African American community still has to be here for us to even reflect that population? Does it have to be 0.01 and still be 60% of the youth there? The other revenue point, and I'll shut up, is that we are proposing to build a 512-bed jail for a total of $500 million to the general fund at a very high interest rate. We don't need to do that. We're the most underpopulated jail in the state. Okay? We're overpopulated with another bias, the mentally ill. The mentally ill don't need to be in jail in order to get treatment. They need treatment in the community, which is cheaper than in a jail and is more successful. We have a lot of biases, but racism is at the core. Let's do better.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, Council. My name is Rigo Trejo, city officials. I just wanted to say that last Sunday, the Sunday that just passed, I discharged my parole. So I'm here to represent. I'm here to represent change lives, and people's lives do change. One of the things I noticed in some of the data was that the Hispanics were counted with the whites. Now, I don't know if that's from the Burns Institute or from the council or city officials. But what I do know is that I think, and I would suggest, that the Hispanics and the whites be counted separately so that we can target the problem and the individuals that are incarcerated. And then we can go ahead and help fix the problem. What I do know is that some of the funds should be put into the drug programs, training programs, employment programs, GLIDE services, transitional housing, second chance, five key charters, because they've definitely helped me. I am currently residing at Walden House, and I also represent all the men who are in Walden House. I just wanted to stand up here and say that lives do change. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Hey, how you doing? You know, it kind of hurt my heart to sit up here today, and after the Burns Institute did the presentation, and everyone on the panel, it was like he wasn't appalled about it. And like someone speaker said earlier, was that immediately it should be something done. I don't care what the percentage is, but it's mighty high for African Americans to continue to be arrested at this high rate and be incarcerated at this high rate. And we sit here as if it's nothing and it's okay. And part of the process when people are asking about why is it done, one thing about this, and I know we get tired of hearing this one, but until this country addresses slavery and had that conversation about it, I don't think it will ever change. A lot of this, I can't point my finger at no one because I have to take responsibility for my own actions. But one thing is the systematic, the way this process is. And if we participate in this system the way it is, then we are a part of the problem. And part of that system is, just like what they were presenting today, the first point of contact in anything is the police. Most of the police come outside of San Francisco, don't live in the community, and walk in beats, and being able to address it. So again, they use the term giving people trumped up charges. Secondly, once it gets to the getting incarcerated in the district attorney's offices, being able to read the report, they don't drop the charges and make them lower, a misdemeanor. Because if you're charged with a felony, then necessarily you don't meet the criteria for a pretrial diversion. And the criteria is set up for African Americans to fail so they won't get out. Because if you're convicted of a felony or have a violent offense, you can't get out of custody. So that's another thing with the way the system is. The other side is when you start talking about funding and bringing funding into the into this situation to be able to deal with it, the way you have to do it is go through a proposal process. And the proposal process is written in a language that's not the language that the people I see and deal with every day. And then the people that are actually doing the work don't get anything. But the people that continue in this system that can write a good grant and can pay somebody $5,000 to $10,000 to write it for them, they continue to get the same money and keep this process going. A lot of people always saying that they're here to help African Americans in this system, and I think they really mean it from their heart. But what a lot of these programs do too in San Francisco is continue to handicap African Americans and keep them with their hands out like cups instead of teaching people how to be able to stand up on their own. And then when you were talking about on the Burns Institute about the jail beds and getting jail beds, somebody's getting paid for them jail beds. And it's not going back to that individual who's laying in that bed. So that's just like I'm saying, when you're talking about that, having that addressed. And then like Mr. Henderson, I just want to say to you, I would love to be a part of that process. But I just think that it should be a lot more urgent needs that needs to be addressed immediately, and don't act like the elephant is sitting there and we're not going to deal with it or address it. Because really, honestly for me, and it's not for no particular individual, it was an insult after that presentation and no one was alarmed. This whole thing should have been standing up and everybody should be ready to go out and address this immediately. And this has been going on for years, years, and years. So it's time for it to stop. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Montrell Dorsey, and I am a returning citizen and a new resident to San Francisco, and I couldn't just sit in my seat without coming up and speaking. I heard that there were training programs that were being implemented for the upper administration dealing with the district attorney's office and with law enforcement, but my concern and my issue is how soon and is there a concrete plan for law enforcement, the regular beat officers, to be able to start getting training dealing with personal biases or cultural sensitivities? And is that something that's already being implemented, and how soon will it be implemented?
It is in the basic academy class, so when all the recruits come in, that's part of bias and ethics training and working in training folks when they come in, and then working towards extending that to all advanced officer training as well, with all reoccurring training that occurs for the entire force.
Yeah. Well, for me, it seems like that's where the problem starts, because it's at the beginning with all of the arrest rates that seems to be extremely high. That's the beginning of the poll, right? So if officers are being trained with better sensitivity, better cultural awareness, it seems like that would begin to stem the problem. So that's a concern of mine. I would just like to see what's going to happen with that. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes public comment. What I'd like to do now is take it back to the resolution put forth by Paul Henderson. And maybe if you can restate that, and we do need a second on the record.
So my motion was to create a working group from the council to address this, specifically focused on the data collection problems, as well as prevention and intervention steps to be taken as recommendations from this council.
And include the community at some point?
And to include the community at some point.
And we have a second from Chief Fletcher.
Second.
We have a third.
Third.
One a fourth?
Yeah, fourth. I think we should have it for all, since to make it clear what our intention is. I do want to, let's take a vote.
Is there a discussion?
Yeah.
Discussion.
I don't know. Is it necessary to have a discussion before the vote?
Well, I'd like to, real quickly.
Sure. We're just running short on time.
But one of the principles, I mean, for process, you usually have discussion before a vote. But one of the principles not here is the courts. And we've relieved the courts completely since the inception of this whole console, because that's the court's desire. And I see really no, you know, sort of compelling lever to make the courts be here, because they don't have to be here. But while everybody well articulates the assembly line process that keeps recreating this problem, you know, unless the courts are part of this conversation somehow in some way, I still feel like we're driving a three-wheel car, and something has got to break in requiring the courts to be here. And I just want to sort of mention again, I think part of the outrage, no matter how mellow tone or measured we might sound, nobody should really discount the power of the budget, which is why that shedding light on the limits of this console when we created it 9 years ago. The limits of this console does not have budget authority. All it does is it gives advice to the Board of Supervisors or Room 200, the mayor, if they care to even hear it. And so the process we're undergoing right now, I really can't stress enough that we can do a working group, and that's great, but it has no authority and no impact on the budgetary process. So I hope that if this working group does come to be, and I certainly support its creation, that so goes the political will that is born with it to compel some fiscal response that elevates the importance of this group that is to come into being. Otherwise, I just feel like we're stalling.
How do we do that? I have a question. So how do we do that? How do we do that for the people who don't know?
Well, I mean, we had said there's a larger picture issue. The larger picture is, and I think the Board of Supervisors is frankly so weak and so passive that it is, I think, a travesty that the member of the board is not on this council. And there has not been a member of the Board of Supervisors on this council for years. And I think that there should be outrage by the community and by the department heads here. But the problem is the way that the government has devolved, we're all competing with each other in our budgetary process. And so the fiefdoms of budget now has made it perfectly convenient for the architects of the purse strings to make sure that we're fighting each other. And so while people want to demand change of us, we're completely neutered from affecting any change except in our own fiefdom. But if we don't have money and new money that is able to implement some of the things we'd like to implement, then all we're coming here is barking into the ether. And so I think that what we've attempted before, you know, in the past, why don't we get, you know, a declarative? If this working group's going to come to be, let it then be said that we support bail reform. And that let the courts respond to us. And let's finally take it that we have like meaningful bail reform and make it a pilot in San Francisco. When we were trying to put, you know, electronic monitoring up there as a concrete solution, and we got shot down by certain partners here that are on this Reentry Council from the arms of law enforcement to help alleviate Black and brown populations and others of working class because they couldn't afford bail, we got shot down for that. I think we're beginning to see the cracks of where the Reentry Council is becoming just a little more of a, you know, we're becoming just kind of this footnote of a larger discussion that needs to be taking place. So whatever happens with this working group, I truly recommend that it gets, I think, the muscle or thinks about the muscle that needs to happen. And that might mean going to the ballot. That means going to the ballot and making this a full-fledged commission, because full-fledged commissions correspondingly give you the budget authority in order to, you know, help instruct what budget mechanisms should be. Whether it's 400 police officers, whether it's a new jail, whether it is how we appropriate AB 109 money, we are all fighting each other on this council, even though that I think we're all collectively working hopefully towards the same goal. That's how the system has turned this upside down.
Can I say something, Ross? I think one thing, well, a couple of things is happening, is that one, as you so clearly said, the council, we are fragmented ourselves. All right, that's number one. There's strength in numbers. If you're serious, you're focused, and you're dedication, and you're dedicated to make it happen, we can make it happen. Thank you.
Okay, unless there's any other comment from the council discussion, unless there's any other public comment from the audience, I'd like to move this forward with a vote.
Yeah, well, I agree with Ron that the bail and the courts need to be involved in this process. Otherwise, it's just smoke and mirrors, and you need to follow.
Okay. Unless there's any other comments, public comment or comment from the council, can we put this to a vote? Okay. All in favor of the resolution put forward, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Passes. Thank you. The next question is, you know, what steps we would take. And what we'd like is for the next meeting to have and prepared in anticipation of that meeting a report. And we would ask the staff, I think the suggestion was is that they would meet with the members of the department and members of the council to help put together those ideas. There has to be a community component, as was suggested. And we've empowered the staff to use resources in order to achieve that. But the ultimate goal is to have a plan together that we can work from that states sort of our collective an initiative that we'd like to move forward with.
I'm happy to convene with the staff, and then we can have a call out and an overview and a directive by the next meeting.
Okay, and you're willing to oversee that?
Yep.
Okay, thank you, Paul. All right, we're gonna table the items six through 10, so we would need a motion to do that. Do you have a second?
I second that motion.
Okay. Any public comment on tabling those items? And I might note that there are reports on most of those items in the materials, so you can review that. Okay, we'll vote on the resolution. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, so those items are tabled, thank you. So in conclusion, let me say thank you to all the members and all the members of the public who came out today. The next meeting of the Reentry Council is scheduled for September 15th, 2015, here in this room. Is there a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Okay, a second?
Second.
Craig, seconds. All in favor?
Before you do that, there's the change that the next meeting of the Reentry Council is August 6th.
Yes.
August 6th. That's what I thought. Okay. I'm sorry. The next meeting of Reentry Council is scheduled for August 6th, 2015, here in this room. Let's take a vote on the motion. All in favor?
Aye.
The meeting is adjourned. Thank you.